To the Sunday evening Bible study here at the Berea Church of Christ. I'm so grateful that you've tuned in, and I pray that something will be said today that will encourage you in your walk with the Lord, and that it might help each one of us as we strive to be the kind of people that God would have us be. We are continuing our series on the Sermon on the Mount, and we're going to look at a subject entitled Love Without Limits. As we get started, I wanted to reiterate something that was said this morning during our worship. Our leadership team at Berea, including our elders, deacons, and ministers, all met this morning, and we were able to kind of hone out some plans for the next few weeks and months. And we're delighted to be able to share with all of you that we will begin our Sunday evening worship back here at the building, Lord willing, next Sunday evening, January the 31st. And then we will continue that into our Wednesday evening Bible study, which will also be here at the church building. So we're excited about that. I know that Brayden is moving forward with plans immediately with our young people in the youth group, the middle school and senior high students. And they'll begin doing some activities together this coming Wednesday night. Of course, as always, during this season of COVID, we're going to use social distancing and using masks and other things as we have the opportunity to do. And there'll be lots of details about that in the bulletin. But we are ready to move forward and get back as close as we can get to a normal time of fellowship, a normal time of Bible study and of worship together, because we so desperately need that. So we're excited for the next few days and weeks that lie ahead. And then, Lord willing, on in February, we will have our Sunday morning Bible classes get started back up as well. And again, we'll give you more details about that in the days that lie ahead. But we're just looking forward to that, getting back to a more sense of normalcy in a time that we can all be together. So I hope that you're excited about that. And if you have the opportunity, we want you to be here in person and share the worship, share the fellowship, share the love here at Berea. We're looking forward to it. So let's get into our lesson tonight. And as we get into our lesson, I ran across something the other day in doing some reading that I thought was fascinating and was indicative of the times that we live in. I want you to listen to this. There's something in the last few years that has become a phenomenon. It's called misophonia. Misophonia literally means the hatred of sound. It was a term proposed about 20 years ago as a condition in which negative emotions, thoughts, and physical reactions are triggered by specific sounds, like somebody smacking their gum, chewing it real loud, slurping your food, just whatever sounds. The one that I thought of immediately was nails on the chalkboard. I think for those of us that are a little bit older and we remember the old slate chalkboards when somebody would take their fingernails and just down through there. But sometimes there are sounds that people make that get on our last nerve. And much of it has to do with chewing sounds and things like that. But it could be any number of things. Just little things that people do that maybe get on your nerves. But what's interesting about that is we live in a day and time in which people are not unabashed about letting it be known. In a time in which maybe there was a little more decorum, a little more discretion used years ago, where people would, it might get something that was not offensive, but kind of got to them a little bit, but they wouldn't say anything. But nowadays, if somebody doesn't like something, let me tell you something, they have no bones about expressing themselves and saying, hey, could you chew a little quieter? Hey, could you chew with your mouth closed? Do you really need that chewing gum? How long have you been chewing that gum? And any number of things that get on people's last nerves. And what's interesting is people don't seem to mind to hurt other people's feelings. People don't seem to mind putting people in their place. Now, I think there's a time in which we can be honest with one another and we can do things that are transparent with each other. But that has nothing to do with just being considerate and kind and going the second mile with people. And those are the questions that we're going to answer tonight in the Sermon on the Mount as Jesus answers, what are we going to do about love? What is love? What extent do we need to love others? And so tonight, our scripture begins with Matthew chapter 5, beginning with verse 43. Again, you have heard that it hath been said, love your neighbor and hate your enemies. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be the sons of your Father in heaven. He causes the sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your brothers, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do like that? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Now, Jesus is still setting the record straight. There were a lot of things that became verbal traditions of men. People would add things to what God had said, and that became the tradition, and really became the standard, to where the traditions of men became even more important than the Word of God. Jesus said, in vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrine the commandments of men. And there are things like that that we could do today, where we go beyond what the Word says, and we bind that on people. And we're going to say, you have to do this, or you have to quit doing that, or you do it my way. And if you don't, you're wrong. If you don't, I'm not going to have fellowship with you. If you don't, then we can't be brethren. And those concepts are foreign to God's word. We have to find ways in which we love each other and can have relationships with each other in spite of our differences, in spite of our shortcomings, in spite of our idiosyncrasies, the things that get on everybody's last nerve. We have to have the love and the grace and the mercy of Jesus inside of us through the Spirit that oozes love and acceptance and gives people space, gives people consideration. Those are things that ought to be a part of our daily lives as Christians. He says, now you've heard that it was said that you love your neighbor, but you hate your enemy. I recall that one time Jesus was asked the question, and who is my neighbor? And of course, he tells the parable of the Good Samaritan, how that Samaritan was robbed and left for dead. And as luck would have it, as the old saying goes, a priest came by, a Levite came by, but they didn't want to become unclean. So they passed by on the other side and left him for dead. And then a Samaritan came by. And even though, according to the account, the person injured was a Jew, it was the Samaritan who befriended him. It was the Samaritan who provided medical assistance. It was the Samaritan that put him up on his own animal, and he himself walked while he carried this person who was seriously wounded to the inn where he was cared for. And after the time came for him to leave, he even left extra money so the innkeeper would see to it that this wounded man was cared for. And Jesus made it abundantly clear that the man who cared for this stranger was in fact neighborly, was the one in which had the spirit, had the mind and the heart that God seeks after. And so if someone wants to be our enemy, let that be their choice. There may be people in our lives that try to make life miserable for us, but we need to do everything in our power not to give them a reason to hate us. We need to do everything in our power to give them a reason to know that we love them, that we want a solid, healthy relationship with them, and whatever needs to be said or done to make that right, to make it available, we want to do that. But Jesus said that I say unto you, love your enemies, pray for those who despitefully use you and persecute you. When was the last time that you ever gave serious consideration to how you could bless an enemy? Maybe not we think about other people in our life as being specifically enemies, but people you don't like. Are there people that you don't want to speak to them, you don't want to be around them, you walk away out of the way not to have to deal with them? I remember years ago, I was speaking with an elder and he shared with me that he and the preacher at that time had gotten into it and they didn't speak to each other for about 3 years. And I said, wow. Inside I was going, wow. I mean, how does that happen? How do leaders in the Lord's church have something to come between them that's so contentious that they didn't speak for that long? Well, I know that that's not God's will, that we would allow whatever the issue is to come between us and our relationship with one another. We need to value people in our life more than issues or more than our feelings or more than our egos, more than our pride. We need to do whatever we can do to love those, even those who are unlovable, even those who have been mean to us or done us wrong, that we're going to love them and forgive them. Maybe even when they haven't forgiven us, even when they haven't even asked for forgiveness, we're going to do everything in our power to mend that fence, to build a bridge. He goes on to say, think about what God does for each one of us. For God causes the sun to rise on the righteous and the unrighteous. And aren't you glad? Aren't you glad that God doesn't go with the ebb and flow of our faithfulness and of our relationship with him? Because we all struggle. There are times in all of our lives when maybe we are at a mountaintop experience with God. We can't get any closer to God. We love him so much and we sense his presence. The Spirit is alive in us and things seem to be going great spiritually. But you know, there's also times in all of our lives when we're in the valley, when we have isolated ourselves from God. Maybe we're hurt. Maybe we're struggling. and we don't pray like we should. We don't study God's word as we should. We don't fellowship with the church as we should. And we, like a coal of fire brought out of the fire and laid out on the hearth, we start growing gray and cold. And aren't you glad that God's love is unwavering? Regardless of where we are in our relationship with Him, His love is steadfast. His position to us is unchangeable. If we feel that there's something between us and God, or if God seems a long way away, just realize who put the wall in place. Just realize who stepped away. It wasn't the Lord. Not only does He send the sun on the righteous and the unrighteous, He does so with the rain. He sends the rain to everyone, whether good or evil, whether faithful or unfaithful. And aren't you glad that God provides for us regardless of our present circumstances? And then He asks this very poignant question. If you love those who love you, what reward do you have? What good is that? Do not even the tax collectors think like that, live like that? So basically, I'll pat your back if you'll pat mine. You do something good for me, I'll do something good for you. You ever do me wrong, and buddy, I'm writing you off. That is the way of the world. That's the way of the natural man without Jesus. It can't be the way it is with those of us trying to live a Christian life. In fact, I think one of the things that's kind of missing in our day and time is giving people the benefit of the doubt. So often we jump to conclusions. We think that somebody brushed by us on the way out of the auditorium, that they are being rude, or that they didn't want to speak to me, or they didn't speak to me, and automatically take offense at that. And not saying, well, they probably had something on their mind, or they were looking for someone, or something, whatever. We give them the benefit of the doubt. Now, we live in a very cynical and critical society. And folks, we cannot let that rub off on us. We can't be cold-hearted. We can't be hard-hearted. We can't think the worst of everybody at every occasion. We have to love people and give them the benefit of the doubt. And when we give people that space to be human, to have a hard day, for things not to be going good, and not allow that to come between us, not allow that to start something that we can't finish, that's powerful. That's needful. That's God calling us to a higher level of learning. He says, and if you greet only your brothers, what are you doing much more than others? Do not even the pagans do that? Be perfect. Seek for completeness, wholeness, perfection that only can come in Christ. Not that we are ever perfect ourselves, but that we strive for perfection. We want to do things right every chance we get. We are not going to justify and rationalize a bad attitude, a bad heart, an evil spirit, a spirit of ill will. Those things cannot take up residency in us. It does so much damage. It does so much harm. I know there are people that their relationships have been broken or severed over the most minor things, but they allow that to build up, as the old saying goes, from a molehill to a mountain, for something so small to create something so huge, so seemingly unconquerable. So as we get toward the end of our lesson tonight, thinking about loving without limits, I think the Apostle Paul shared some beautiful words in Romans, the 12th chapter. Beginning with verse 9, he says, love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to that which is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Honor one another above self. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer, share with God's people who are in need, and practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay evil for evil, but be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as much as lies within you, Live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, saith the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will bring heaping coals of fire upon his head. Now notice this last verse of chapter 12. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. As we mentioned in our early service today, and if you weren't here with us, I hope that you'll tune in and catch it. It's provided on Facebook. But we mentioned the fact that being the people that God called us to be in our relationships with one another is a dynamic difference from what the world is like. It's a breath of fresh air to be people who are kind beyond measure, who are just so giving, so generous, so forgiving, just so interested in what's going on in other people's lives. And when people are struggling, when people need help, they're the first to pitch in, the first to say, hey, I love you, I care about you, I need to know what's wrong, I want to help you. That those are the people who are making a powerful force for good in our world today. And I suggest to you that right here, right now, in January of 2021, we need a breath of fresh air. We need some people who love everybody, who care about everybody, who are not taking sides with other people, who are not interested in animosity, who are not into bitterness or rage or hatred toward other people. We've had enough of all that. We've had enough division. We've had enough of separation. It's time for God's people to bring the world together. And we do that by being the people God called us to be the people that Jesus wants us to be the people the Spirit yearns for us to be. I pray that for all of us. I pray that this season that we are entering into at the beginning of this year will be a new dawn, not only for our community, not only for this congregation, but for our country, for our world, that we might breathe a breath of fresh air, that we might say to the world, we've had enough of this, and we're ready for a change. And we can do that. We're empowered to do that. We are called to do that in Jesus' name. Thank you so much for tuning in to our Sunday evening time of Bible study. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that you love us in our seasons of faithfulness and the times in which we struggle with you. We're grateful of your consistency with us, your unconditional love for us. And I pray that for all of us tuning in right now, that we might yearn for that in our own lives, that we will espouse unconditional love to others, that we will not be people who are bitter, that we will not hold grudges, that we will not hold on to our enemies, but that we will pray for them, that we will do good things for them, that we will transform them and change them through the Spirit of Christ into our friends. Help us to be what you would have us be. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Again, thanks for tuning in. We'll look forward to being together online one more night this coming Wednesday night. Brother Lee will have our lesson online. And then following that, beginning next Sunday, January 31st, we will be here in the auditorium for our worship. We'll be in the auditorium for a Bible study, and we will be in the auditorium for our Sunday evening service. And then, of course, as I've already mentioned, the teenagers will begin their time of fellowship and Bible study in person this coming Wednesday night. They get the jump start on the rest of us. Exciting times are ahead for us here at Berea. I hope you'll come and be a part of it. And if you are, God bless you. Keep on keeping on. And may everything we do every day please God. Have a great week. Just as